Merisa Davis has written a powerful book called Bill Cosby is Right. And in her book, she talks about Bill Cosby's pound cake speech delivered in 2004. We're going to break it down today here on Babbie's House. It's coming up right now.
At Babbie's house, Babbie's house, everybody is family. Oh, welcome to Babbie's house.
Hello, everybody, and welcome to Babbie's house, where everybody is a member of the family. That's what we love to say around here. We invite you into Babbie's house, and hopefully and prayerfully today, you'll enjoy this discussion today. My good friend Merisa Davis has written a book called Bill Cosby is Right. And in her book, she defends, basically, his stance, his pound cake speech of 2004 that was delivered at a big NAACP event. And in it, he expresses his passion, his outrage, really, about some of the things that are going on in the black community and even in the black church. And we'll talk about that. Merisa Davis and a very good friend and I will kind of break it down for you and express our hearts and our minds on the matter and talk more about this book called Bill Cosby Was Right. And so stay tuned for that. But right now, I want to encourage you with a song. You know, the Bible tells us in the 5th chapter of the book of Matthew, it says to let your light so shine before men that they may see your good works and glorify your Father who is in heaven. Be encouraged by these words.
In the parking lot of the coffee shop just the other day, smiled and she said, well, I'm doing okay, and I felt her pain. I took her hand in mine and said, it's gonna work out fine. But as she turned, I wondered, did I just hand her a line? What she needed most was a word of hope and a prayer or two, a little more time and a timely word could pull her through. And so I think of her and I wonder too, is anybody hurting sitting right next to you? Shine the light, share your faith, show the world that Jesus is Jesus is the way. Together we can make a difference. Be a beacon in the dark of night. Share your faith, hold it high, shine the light. Anywhere you go, any country road or city street, any lonely life, hurt, somebody in need, they all ask one thing, where is love and truth? But if you know Jesus, then you know what to do. Our Father.
I'm Jessica Mendoza, U.S. Olympic gold and silver medalist. I never take my eyesight for granted, and neither should you. It doesn't matter how old you are, you could be losing your vision to glaucoma without knowing it. Take care of your sight. Schedule regular eye exams for yourself and those you love. Call 1-800-437-2423 or go to ahaf.org for free information and publications from National Glaucoma Research.
Season after season, year after year, generation after generation, our national forests that give us beauty to behold and places to play also provide clean water to drink, clean air to breathe, wood for our homes, and places to live. But millions of acres of our national forests have been lost to fire, to insects, and to disease. They need to be replanted, and soon. And now the Arbor Day Foundation asks for your help to replant our national forests so that seasons from now and generations from now, we will still have forests to enjoy and a place to live. To support the Arbor Day Foundation in replanting our national forests, visit arborday.org. See what we're doing. See how you can help.
Welcome back, everybody. I'm so honored to have on Babbie's House today two of my dearest friends. And I want to introduce Merisa Davis, who is the author of Bill Cosby Was Right, or Bill Cosby Is Right, But What Should the Church Be Doing About It? A member of Cosby's family speaks out in his defense and provides spiritual solutions. And we're going to get into the content of the book in just a moment. But welcome to Babbie's House. Welcome back to Babbie's House, Merisa. It's good to have you. You came on the show earlier this year, and we introduced your book to our audience. But I felt like we needed to go around again and talk more in depth about the content of this book and bring on some good friends so that we could really discuss some of the problems and some of the solutions that we as parents, as members of society, and members of the church could be doing to help the black family. We're going to talk about your book in just a moment, but I want to introduce somebody very special to me. He's a minister. He is a worshiper. He has a great history of working in a correctional institution. He's a mentor. He's a teacher. He's a fine preacher. He's married to a beautiful wife, Carol, has beautiful children, Reverend Everett Spencer, otherwise known as Rev Ev Bishop. But welcome to Babbie's House, my friend.
Thank you.
It's good to have you back.
Good to be here.
And I thought, you know, when it comes down to discussing some of the powerful subjects in this book, I thought, you know, we need to get somebody who can help us with some stimulating conversation. And I turned to you to join us today because after so many dinners at our house, and they always end up on some subject that we're just dissecting down to the core. And I thought it would be a good thing to have you on today to help us talk about this, about the content of this book, which is so near and dear to all of us being parents and being Christians and leaders. That's right, and leaders in the church. Merisa, you wrote this book called Bill Cosby Is Right, But What Should the Church Be Doing About It? Why is this so passionate to you? I want you to kind of give us a little insight into your relationship with Bill Cosby and a little bit about the background of his famous pound cake speech delivered in 2004, and where it was delivered, and what's all the uproar about?
Well, the pound cake speech was controversial because Dr. Cosby was giving the speech to what he thought was just a black audience. Somehow or another, it leaked out to the press and people found out about it, and then the uproar started. But his comments were directed primarily to black Christians,
yes,
who were at the forefront of the civil rights movement. And he was just pointing out, you know, we've come a long ways, but we have a long ways to go.
Yes. And this event was at an NAACP annual event. Mm-hmm. And he was addressing this audience. And, you know, they're expecting, you know, a night of comedy.
Jokes.
You know, yeah, funny stuff from Bill Cosby. But instead, he laid down the law. And he pointed a lot of fingers, particularly at at the black community, at the black family, the black male, the black church, the church in general,
yes,
the government. I mean, he was right. And in your opinion, his opinion as well, there's a lot that we as a society, as parents, and as the church can be doing about it. Give us some information, a little background information about the content of the famous pound cake speech.
Well, they called it the pound cake speech because part of the speech was laced with jokes, and one of the jokes that he gave that night was about how that we have black males that are getting shot by the police over something simple, something as simple as stealing a piece of pound cake. And you end up resisting arrest and getting shot in the head. And we see these stories all the time about how incidents escalate and then the police get involved and then a gun goes off and next thing you know we have another funeral of another black male.
Mm-hmm.
So he was kind of joking about it, but it's a very serious subject. It's also referred to as the Gettysburg Address.
Wow.
Because he kind of talked bad about some of the people in the lower middle and lower class classes of our society, an African American society, and he accused them of not holding up their end of the deal when it comes to Brown versus Board and all of the benefits that we have been given through the lawsuit.
Yes, I want to read a little excerpt just so that you can kind of feel Bill Cosby's passion concerning this subject. The paragraph is titled Caught Off Guard. The elite old school crowd of black intelligentsia was rather taken aback and caught off guard. They came ready for a night of comedy and amusement and instead got something totally different as Cosby held up a mirror to the conscience of black society. The state of blacks and public education was no laughing matter. Bill Cosby gave it to black America with both barrels shooting straight from the hip. Since Cosby is best known as a comedian, initially many in the audience didn't quite know just how to take it or how to react. First there was stunned silence, then there was laughter and clapping as Cosby continued his critique and commentary of contemporary black America. And in his speech, because I saw the reruns of it, and of course it was all over the news, and it made major headlines, and they were talking about it for days, and he talked about the conditions of the black family, the black male. I remember him talking about, you know, the pants, you know, dragging the ground, and about the some serious things concerning the condition of the black male.
But he really he was equally as vocal in his criticism of the way that a lot of the females carry themselves too, and the way that they're having so many babies out of wedlock.
True.
And not taking care of the children that they have. And so he really laid it down for both sexes.
Yes.
He really did. So the thing about it is, when the news came out, you know, you have a minute and a half maybe to do a story. As a reporter, I know that's what the time frame that I used to use when I would give a news report. And there's no way in a minute and a half that you could go into the depth of what Dr. Cosby was talking about. So I had to write a book.
Mm-hmm.
And in 300 and some pages, I was able to break it down and give the whole entire speech, because the news media did not report on the fact that Bill Cosby was addressing Christians.
Yes.
With his speech.
Mm-hmm.
They edited all that out.
Mm.
And I know as a Christian working in a secular newsroom, they're scared of religion a lot of times. So I took it on myself to write this book.
Yes.
And part of my passion also is because Dr. Cosby is family, and I didn't like it when people attack my family.
Yes. Talk to us about your relationship with Dr. Cosby.
Well, I'm a country cousin. I'm not one of the ones that he hangs out with a lot, but I am blood, and I put the genealogy in the book so that couldn't anybody say that, oh, you're not really Bill Cosby's cousin. I did like the book of Matthew, and I put the genealogy, my right to be part of this family.
Yes.
Right in the front of the book.
You know, the book brings out a lot of history. You've done a lot of research in writing this book, and you bring out some of the history of the African American church, and we find that the African American church was in the forefront of the anti-slave movement. You find the black church in the forefront of the civil rights movement. Many of the leaders of the civil rights movement were preachers.
And from Atlanta.
From Atlanta. But you bring out in your book that it's a wonderment as to why the African or the church at large doesn't deal with things like sex, homosexuality, the blight on our society, the problems with the black male, the problems with the family. Is it just our imagination, or does the church have its head in the sand in a lot of these issues, Brother Everett?
To some regard. Maybe there is some of that, but there is an inswell, a growing a part of the church that are willing now to say, let's address this, let's address it openly, honestly, let's deal with it, let's see what the scripture actually says about it, and let's start talking about these things. For example, you know that I go to a church in West Georgia. My pastor happens to be a Caucasian man. But he did a whole series about sex on a Sunday morning, and it was interesting to watch the response of people, because people still have it in their mind that sex shouldn't be talked about in church. But the Bible talks about it. So if the Bible talks about it, we should be talking about it. And if we talk about these things and talk about them honestly and openly and deal with them responsibly, then the culture has the right perspective of what God intended for these things. When we don't talk about it, then the only perspective the culture gets is the perspective from the world, and that perspective is never correct.
It's warped.
It's always warped, and it's always immoral.
Yes. Merisa, you talk about in your book, you go deeply into a lot of statistics. You've even interviewed some real powerful heavyweight politicians. And one of those politicians was General Colin Powell.
Yes.
And you had an in-depth interview with him. And you write about that interview in your book. Tell us about that.
Well, first of all, I just about fell on the floor when they called and told me that they were going to do the interview, because I was just stepping out on faith. And when I talked to General Powell, I focused mostly on education, and he has started an organization called America's Promise, and he and his wife are part of it, and it is to promote education and particularly graduation rates within the African-American community. So I focused the interview on the statistics and what can we do to build things up. And the conversation turned to his home church. And he goes to a very upper crust type ministry. I believe it's Episcopalian. Don't quote me on that. But he is in Washington, D.C., in that area, and he is an African-American being part of that church, but he has started a program within his church to reach out across the railroad tracks, whereas the rich white families that go to that church are part of a ministry, whereas they go into the hood and take kids into their homes and mentor them and talk to them, and they have pool parties, and they basically show them that there is a better way. And it's a ministry. We have so many of our churches that will sponsor a minister or a missionary to Africa or Haiti or whatever, but they will not reach out across the railroad tracks to that black person that lives the next county over.
Mm-hmm.
So he was pointing that out, and I think it was profound.
That's interesting that you would bring that up. Because sitting at this table, knowing both of you personally, I know firsthand that although you're African Americans, we have had to matriculate. We have had to live in a society as a minority. You mentioned the fact that you go to a church that is pastored by a white pastor, and I know your church, and we went to that church for a good while, and I love Church of Mirror Lake, and you went to Liberty University and Thomas Road Baptist Church in Lynchburg, Virginia, and I went to a predominantly all-white college and have been a member of a church that has been predominantly white for a long time, and oftentimes I found myself, okay, this is cool, and then every once in a while something will like jerk my chain to remind me, okay, Babbie, you are still a black African American in a white man's world.
Yeah.
Am I by myself on this?
Oh, absolutely not. I mean, one of the things that Pastor Tony Ashmore, my pastor, and I talk about often is that in order for this to work, in order for racial reconciliation to work within the church, there has to be an appreciation of the cultures. There has to be a true love for one another's differences, our differences. He says it this way. He said, there's nothing worse than a white man trying to act black.
Well, and it's funny, too.
Well, I will point out and agree with Brother Everett that a church without diversity in its leadership is lacking. Because one of the very first people that was baptized in the New Testament was the Ethiopian eunuch. God's plan for the church is that it be multicultural and diverse.
Exactly.
And we know that Dr. Martin Luther King said that the most segregated hour in America is 11 o'clock on Sunday morning, and it's not right. It's not right. And Brown versus Board actually opened the doors for blacks and whites to worship together.
Hold that thought. We're going to come back after this break. Stay with me. You stay with me as well. Come back after this break for more wonderful, stimulating conversation. We'll be right back after this break with more of Babbie's House. Stay with me.
If you're a parent, listen closely to the voices of meningitis.
It was a Tuesday. Becky said she didn't feel well.
On Wednesday, we said our final goodbyes.
I was there when my son took his first breath, and I was there when he took his last.
Not everyone who gets meningitis dies.
I wasn't sure she'd make it. The infection spread so fast.
We learned about the vaccine after he got sick.
We are the voices of meningitis. David got it when he was 13.
Terry was only 5.
Tyler lost fingers.
I lost my kidney.
My son
did not have to die.
It was a virus.
Parents need to know.
Go get vaccinated.
Preteens and teens are at greater risk.
These are the voices of meningitis. I'm Lori Loughlin, adding my voice. Meningococcal meningitis may be rare, but it's often devastating. You can help prevent it. Get vaccinated. Health officials recommend vaccination for preteens and teens. Talk to your child's school nurse or healthcare provider, and visit voicesofmeningitis.org to learn more.
Compulsive eating affects millions of people worldwide. These are just some of the symptoms. If you feel powerless over food and unable to control the way you eat, you're not alone. Overeaters Anonymous can help. Through shared experience, strength, and hope, we provide an effective program and the support you need to stop compulsive eating. For more information about Overeaters Anonymous or to find a meeting in your area, visit our website at oa.org. Welcome to Overeaters Anonymous. Welcome home.
Welcome back to Babbie's House. I have two of my dearest friends at the table with me. We've been discussing Merisa Davis's book. Merisa, thank you for writing this book. Her book is called Bill Cosby is Right, and it's in response to Bill Cosby's pound cake speech of 2004 and his expressing in a very demonstrative manner his displeasure with the black community and the black church, the black family, the fracturing and the breaking down of the black community, the black family. And you worked in a correctional institution for a lot of years, Brother Everett Spencer, and you bring out some statistics in your book. Let me read them. The black male comprises only 6% of the population, yet the black male represents 35% of special education students, which I find to be alarming, and 50% of the prison inmates. And is the black male that problematic, or is there something happening in the water that we're not aware of, Brother Spencer?
Well, the When I left the Ohio Department of Corrections a little over 5 years ago, the recidivism rate at that time was somewhere around 69%. That means for every 10 that they were sending home, 7 were coming back. And when you watch these types of things, the Bible says this. It says in Malachi 4, it says, in that day I'll return again the hearts of the fathers to their sons and the hearts of the sons to their fathers, or else I'll smite the earth with a curse. The curse of fatherlessness, to me, is what we see in the black community. What we're seeing is people who have no identity, and so they act out and do these things that they think gives them an identity. They think, this is what makes me a man. I'm doing what I have to do. These are conversations I've had with guys, sitting down, talking to them about what they've done to end up in prison, and listening to them. Once you get them past the justifications, once you get them past all of the stuff, it comes down to, nobody didn't tell me that I shouldn't do this. Now, when you take this and combine it with the fact that we're seeing for the first time a generation of black men who do not know God. The Bible says there arose a generation that knew not God nor feared any of his precepts. Mm. We're seeing in the black community, the first generation, my son, who is 24, told me that his basketball team was the first group of young men he had ever talked to. They had never been to church. Not one black male on his basketball team ever been to church. They didn't know anything about church. So we're seeing the first generation of black men who do not know anything about God in the context of church, the way the church teaches you to have good morals, the way the church teaches you to have care for your fellow man, the way the church teaches you to have care for the other person. In the city I live in, Douglasville, right now, they're dealing with a young man who was beaten to death at
arbitrarily, just picked out.
Yeah, beaten to death at a party.
I guarantee you, if you will interview each of those young men that are alleged to be a part of this crime, you'll find out that they grew up in a fatherless home.
Most likely.
And well, you know what, folks? Here again, we are out of time. But you know what the bottom line is? Is there an answer? And the answer is, yes, there is an answer. The answer is in you. The answer is in you, parents. And we need to do something about it. Thank you so very much for being my guest on Babbie's House. Thank you. And thank you for being my very special guest here on Babbie's House. Pick up Marisa's book, Bill Cosby is Right. And we'll see you next time here on Babbie's House. God bless you until then.